Our presenter, our main talk today is, as you've seen from the promotional material, is Phyllis Frye. And I don't want to tell too much of her story. She has a Wikipedia article, which is awesome. I don't want to tell too much of her story, because she's going to want to tell us quite a bit of that herself, so I'll let her do that. But Phyllis is a graduate of Texas A&M, and this is fascinating, with a BS in civil engineering. And she has an MBA and a JD degree from the University of Houston. She has been a longtime trial attorney, and on November 7th, 2010, she was appointed associate judge for the City of Houston Municipal Court, appointment made by Mayor Denise Parker, who has also spoken at Houston with. So we're thrilled to have Phyllis with us today. She was originally scheduled to speak on the day that, like, the weekend at Harvey hit. And so this is a rescheduling. I know she must be a very, very busy person. And so we're just thrilled and very appreciative that she could accommodate us in her schedule. So let's give a warm welcome to Houston Oasis to Phyllis.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And this is me, 14 years old. I am an Eagle Scout, backcountry report, you can read a lot of the other stuff there. I'm going to race through these slides so that we'll have time for Q&A. And also, this slide presentation and a flash drive that contains most of what was written about me or I've written myself over the last 40 years that I've been out as an activist is going to be placed on your website, Johnny. So the main thing I'm going to say is that I didn't become a girl because I couldn't cut it as a boy. I was extremely so successful that as a senior in high school in San Antonio, Texas, I was the cadet colonel of my ROTC unit. And you can see all the other things that I did in high school. So once again, did I become a girl later on because I couldn't cut it as a guy? No, I was very successful as a guy. It wasn't me, but I was coping as best I could. This is me at Texas A&M, senior roots and all, and I graduated. Mike left out one of my degrees he had for. I have a master's also in engineering, and I'm licensed in engineering. But anyway, and this is one of the last pictures of me in 1974. I grew a beard on three different occasions trying to be a guy. This is me with my son, who is now about 47 years old. I say that because we don't have any communication, which is sad, but that's the way it is. This is October 1979. This is one of the earliest pictures of Phyllis, and you can see I was leading the Texas section of the 1975 March on Washington for gay rights, and I was having a good time. This is the summer of 1980. I was in my third year of law school, and I had put together a group called Law Students Friends of Gays Asterisks, and the Gays Asterisks was then my attempt at an inclusive term because we did not have LGBT at the time. So anyway, and you can read that slide when you get it online because I'm going to go through here. This is when I was sworn in and became a lawyer in May of 1981. And this is when I did the Donahue show in 1989. It was a show entitled Disowned by Families because I was and still have been disowned by my family. And I was hoping that I had been Phyllis then for approximately 13 years out of the closet. And I was hoping that my family or my extended family or friends of my family, somebody would see the show and tell my folks, hey, she's not what you think she is. She's really a nice person, articulate, blah, blah, blah. Well, it didn't do any good. But it was a good show, and as you can tell, I didn't have any gray hair at the time. This is me when I was practicing mostly criminal defense law down at the Harris County Courthouse. And I wore hats. That's another story. I look good at hats, and so I wore hats. And I came to the prosecutors and asked the hat. Oh, hats are going to be in court this morning. And when you're called a lot of different things, being called a hat's okay. This is me speaking in October 1995 at the second National Transgender Lobby Days in Washington, D.C. And this and other things I was doing at the time is how I became known as the grandmother of the National Transgender Legal and Political Movement. Not the grandmother of the transgender movement and somebody else, but of the National Legal and Political Movement. Every time I do this, I start thinking about somebody else who does that, so I... Anyway, now you all have a picture that you like. Well, I like that picture, so there it is. And this is me when I was sworn in as the first ever closet transgender judge. And if you look at this picture, and you look at this picture, and you look at me now, you'll tell that I lost 75 pounds. I started losing about 5 years ago. I was very much overweight. I was pre-diabetic. I had a lot of health issues. And so I finally decided to lose weight, which has nothing to do with transgender, but it was a great achievement, in my opinion, to lose 75 pounds and keep it off. And if you want to know the secret, there is no secret. You've got to want it, you've got to work out, you've got to eat less, and you've got to write down your weight every single day on the calendar so you can keep track. New York Times, colon Phyllis Frye. Believe it or not, and I still get chills every time I tell people this, I knew it was going to be in the New York Times. I had been interviewed, and I was told it was going to be the New York Times, and I was told when it was coming out. And I figured, well, I'll be on page 9, section whatever it is, blah, blah, blah. Well, that Sunday morning, my wife and I were grocery shopping, and she was at the newsstand, and she just couldn't believe what she was seeing. And she called me over, and I was on the front page, above the fold of the Sunday New York Times. You can clap on that. And it's an excellent article. They only got one thing wrong. It was a minor thing. You might go do it and do it. I became a lifetime member of the National Equal Scout Association. And hopefully, with all of that, I will have put all these stereotypes away. I do want to say one other thing. My wife and I celebrate our 44th anniversary last June. She's now, real quickly about the LGBTI, for intersex, some people add an A for ally, some people add a Q for queer. It's all good, it's all inclusive, and that's all that matters. But you need to understand that there's three terms involved. One is sexual orientation, which is not the same as gender identity, which is not the same as gender expression. And if you need more clarification during the Q&A, that's fine, but I need to go through these slides so you'll have a Q&A. But if you are with any group or any business or on any board and you're wanting to do a non-discrimination statement that includes the entire LGBTIQA community, make sure that sexual orientation is protected, make sure that gender identity is protected, and make sure that gender expression is covered. Now, I'm going to go into a couple areas of law because that's what I do. I have a six-person law firm in the city of Houston, and we cover a lot of different areas in LGBTIQ areas, and we work with supportive straight people. Actually, three of the lawyers in the firm are straight lawyers because they want the piece of the action of the civil rights work that my firm does and the other three lawyers, including me, who are LGBTI. And those of our clients, believe it or not, are supportive straight people who come to us because they want a piece of that action. Now, as I go through the law, you're going to see a lot of slides that I've struck through. And I did that intentionally because when these slides were initially created, it was before January. And since January, a lot of the stuff that we had is either going away or is being attacked or has already been taken away. And I want to really impress that upon you, how much damage this president and his administration have done to the transgender community. Okay, transgender discrimination. The EEOC, the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, ruled in 2012 unanimously that transgender people were covered under the 1964 Civil Rights Act. That has been attacked in the courts. We don't know what's going to happen because we have a new Supreme Court. And when one bad guy dies, he's replaced by another bad guy. So I don't know what's going to happen, but that's the way it was. And also covered by the EEOC is sexual orientation discrimination. That's being attacked. Okay, here's what's going on. Rulings in the various federal courts dealing with transgender law. You can read that when you get to it. Now, as far as education, as you may know, bullying and harassment are the principal founding principles that have gone into LGBTI protection in schools, have gone into the gay straight alliances, and have gone into the other things that they're trying to protect kids from committing suicide, kids from being bullied, not only by their fellow students, but by teachers and counselors. And so that's the bedrock, trying to prevent bullying and harassment against LGBTIQA students. Now, we had a decision which has been appealed up to the United States Supreme Court, got kicked back down, and is now probably going to be moved because Jeff Sessions and Betsy DeVos in their positions have both made it that way. In 2016, the Department of Education, Department of Justice issued a joint letter to anybody and everybody that was a school that got federal funding that no longer can you harass and discriminate against transgender children in your school. And if this is the gist of it, and you can read that, but that's all on now. That's the website used to be on. It's all on. Trump Sessions to the boss got rid of it. And now there is one thing that's still available if you want to go to txtns.org, the Texas Non-Discrimination Summit. It's going to have its ninth annual convention in this coming summer, and it has a website that shows all of the Texas schools, districts, and universities that have sexual orientation, gender identity, and gender expression protections in their school policies. As you know, Governor Patrick, Lieutenant Governor Patrick, and the Senate, the Texas Senate, tried to strip all that away during this last legislative session. Luckily, that didn't happen. Gender markers. Okay, so if you're transgender and you are fixing to transition, you need to get your name legally changed, and you need to get your gender marker changed from M to F or F to M on your ID or on your school records, depending on your age. And the important thing is to get all this done way before you have any surgery, if you ever have any surgery. You want to get that done at the very beginning so that when you're in school, you get your school records changed. If you have a driver's license and are applying for a job, you ought to be able to go to the prospective employer with new, clean ID that has your name and gender marker changed. So you want to do it at the beginning. Now, as this slide will show you and the next slide will show you, I've done kids as young as 5 all the way through to adults in their 80s. I've had parents that have come to me with their transgender children, usually the young ones, the young kids. The parents of the young kids are ate up with guilt because they were trying to force their child and punish their child and coerce their child into being who they weren't and who the child was telling them they were. And finally, a family member, a counselor, a friend, somebody, something on television, maybe somebody who attended this presentation today, told them, you know, hey, I think it's trans, you really need to look at this. They come to me and they just ate up with guilt. And I tell them, don't feel guilty, you're a loving parent, you did better than mine did. Let's take this kid to the court now. So when this kid goes back to school, the school will have to address the kid by their proper name, and will have to change their school records to show the like gender marker. And as you know, Lieutenant Governor Patrick and the Texas Senate tried to strip all that away during the last legislative session. But if you go to the Texas Non-Discrimination website, which I just told you about, you'll see there's quite a few school districts in the state of Texas who protect transgender kids. So that's what I do as a lawyer. Now, there's been recent changes in health insurance, military service, housing and shelters, doing transgender. Insurance coverage, I think, is still going to stay, and there's a reason for that. The reason that insurance coverage is probably going to remain and get better for transgender people is because the private sector is so very heavily involved. There's a group, national group called the Human Resources Campaign, Human Rights Campaign, HRC, HRC.org. If you go to their website, you will see that they have a list of employers and businesses nationally who want to be endorsed as a diverse organization by the HRC, because that brings in better employees, that brings in customers or people who want diversity when they spend their money. And there's a lot of transgender things that hoops that these companies have to jump through. And more of them, these are big major companies, are putting sexual orientation and gender identity and gender expression in their company policies, which also affects their insurance carriers. So I think this is going to continue to happen. The reason why I think this is going to continue to happen is because, as you saw with the North Carolina transgender bathroom law, as you saw what was happening in Texas with Lieutenant Governor Patrick and the Texas Senate was trying to do all the bathroom stuff, business, the Texas Association of Business, and fiscally conservative Republicans jumped on the bandwagon to protect transgender people. And I often said, you know, you can have LGBT, FI, FQ, FA, but A stands for allies, don't have that yet. There's not enough of this. Even if all LGBT people came out of the closet, there's not enough of us to be able to pull off any civil rights. It takes the A, it takes the allies, it takes people like you sitting out there to stand up the next time you hear anybody say anything that's anti-queer or for that matter, anything that's racist, especially what's going on now. I don't know about you, but I hope in my heart that every professional football game today, the entire team has been beat. But we can't do it by ourselves. We need allies for global. And I thank you for inviting me to come to this. And I told Mike, if there's other Oasis chapters that want me to come, I will come at no fee other than expenses. Because I travel a lot and give my talks frequently, and I do break in some of my speech for that. But for this kind of group, I would be willing to travel for expenses. Military service, as you know, that's under attack. It's still there, but it's under attack. There it is. Housing and shelters right now. HUD, which is Secretary Hood's brain surgeon, and you thought the pyramids were corner pyramids. Anyway, right now, anybody who has shelters who gets federal money from HUD cannot discriminate against transgender people. I think eventually that may come up on its radar, but right now it isn't. So right now, if you're transgender and you need a home shelter, you don't have to change back. So we'll see what happens. Okay, public accommodations, bathrooms, right? Here goes the bathrooms. Am I blocking? Oh, okay. How about somebody bring me up a chair and I'll just sit down. Okay? Because it's hard to see this. All right. Recent rulings from the EEOC on restroom usage said that transgender should be protected. And by Title VII, who knows how long that's going to last. OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration, best practices, said that the transgender workers have the right to use the restroom corresponding to their gender identity at work. And the previous cases that I said are being attacked, and the DOE DOJ ruling is no longer there. So right now, as far as restrooms go, if it's a company that has 15 or more employees, restroom usage by employees is still covered by 1964 Civil Rights Act. We don't know how long that lasts. We don't know how long it will be challenged. We don't know which Jeff Sessions is going to decide to go after that one, or Trump at 3 o'clock in the morning is going to tweet on that one. Now, what does city and state laws say about transgenders in the restrooms? What we know about North Carolina, and there's other states who are trying to do the same thing. Indiana did it until there's a big business backlash, and Mike Pence backed away from it. I know that Tennessee was getting ready to pass one business. Went against it and they backed off. So we don't know what's going to happen, but we know it went on in Texas. And on the other side, Target has been targeted, pardon the pun. But there are many businesses, as we know, as well as the Texas Association of Business, who are against restroom laws. And I want you to know that during about 2 years ago, we had the big fight in Houston over the HERO ordinance, the Houston Equal Rights Ordinance, and it was all over the bathrooms. The city of Houston in 1968 has a restroom ordinance, and it's still available. And you can Google it, Houston Ordinance 28-20. It's very reasonable. And it says, it shall be unlawful for any person knowingly, intentionally, in a public restroom designated for the exclusive use of the sex opposite to the person's sex. Okay, that's pretty straightforward. And that covers, you know, just about what anybody might be worried about. Without the permission of the owner, tenant, manager, investigator, or other person in charge of the premises. That means if you own the building, you can mark restrooms anywhere you want to. If a male janitor goes into the women's to clean, female janitor goes to the men's to clean, or you're at a convention and it's mostly women, and the hotel puts women over the men's side so that you can, the women can go in there, walk past the urinals, and use the stalls, they have that right. So that's not an infraction of the law. But here's the magic language. In a manner calculated to cause disturbance. I assure you, transgender people don't go to the restroom to cause disturbance. So that ordinance does not hurt transgender people. But during that HERO thing, you saw all these television ads with the dirty old man following the little girl into the restroom stall. So let's address those people who want to cause disturbance. Number one, the Houston ordinance outlaws that. They can be arrested even though it's a class C misdemeanor and fine. Those wishing to commit other crimes, indecent exposure is against the state law. Public lewdness is against the state law. Voyeurism is a felony, especially if it involves a child under 14 years of age. And invasive video recording, somebody goes in there with their cell phone and is taking pictures over the stall of somebody urinating. Why they would do that, I don't know. But that's the big fear. That's also a felony. If a teenage boy who's in school takes his mother's wig and a skirt and a padded bra, puts it in his backpack, goes to school between classes, gathers in the hallway, surrounded by his friends, TDE. He puts all that stuff, goes right in the girls' restroom with his cell phone, taking pictures, or raising his skirt to expose himself, or masturbating himself, or doing any of the things that everybody's worried about. Guess what? As a juvenile, he can be prosecuted and convicted under these same laws. So this whole thing in Austin was just a political thing. Now, for those who also want to do what the dirty old man did by tracking the girl in the shower stall, that's false imprisonment. It's also called unlawful restraint. That's also a felony. Okay. Now, do you want this trans man in the women's restroom? Well, if Dan Patrick had had his law, had had his law saying you don't need to use the restroom of your biological sex or sex at birth, number one, guys, I would be sharing the restroom with you. I don't think you'll want that. This trans man would have to go to the women's restroom. I don't think women you want that. This trans man would be in the women's restroom. I don't think you want that. This trans man and this trans man, who's a very handsome young trans man, would be in the women's restroom. I don't think y'all want that either. So, if you're on the board of a school district, or you're with a university, or you're with some company, and for political reasons, the people that you're fighting with just absolutely have to have some potty protection ordinance. Okay, adopt the city of Houston's ordinance. Shall be unlawful for any person, knowing intentionally, blah, 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 in a manner calculated to cause disturbance that will not hurt transgender people. Why do I know it won't hurt transgender people? Well, I'm looking at the clock. I'm doing okay. Because in the early 90s, the cops in Houston were arresting a lot of male, female transgenders who didn't pass very well and were using women's restrooms. And as an attorney and activist, I got a lot of phone calls from them. To come and represent them. Well, the only way we could get it dismissed is by going to a trial for a jury. And the maximum fine was $500, and the reason we're paying $5,000. So I told him, yes, I'm doing the Trump thing again. I'm going to sit on my hand. I told him this. Go to the court on your court day, dressed as your best transgender woman self, and when your name is called, go to the judge and say, please, may I have a jury trial date, and you'll be set for a jury trial. And then when you go back to your jury trial, go dressed as your best transgender woman self, and the prosecutor will put on their thing, and the police officer will say their thing, and then you'll get up, and you'll testify on your behalf. And you'll say, this is the statute, and it has language that says, in a manner calculated to cause disturbance. Now, if I had, and I was dressed like this, used the men's room, I guarantee you I would have caused disturbance. But I went to the women's room because I didn't want to cause disturbance. And I went in, and I went to the stall, and I locked the stall, and I went to the bathroom, and I unlocked the stall, and I walked out. I didn't stop to comb my hair, I didn't stop to put on my makeup, I didn't stop to check anything, I just went in and went out, not to cause disturbance. Not guilty, not guilty, not guilty, not guilty, not guilty. Prosecutors told the police to quit ticketing on that. So it won't hurt transgender men. Okay, briefly, here's my commercial. This is how you find me. We practice all across the state. If you own a business that has tax problems or estate planning problems, if you own a business or know somebody owns a business who is having problems with employment discrimination or wants diversity training, or if you are an employee who is being discriminated against, if you need help with immigration, if you own a business needing help with commercial contracts, real estate, or business law, if you are none of those but need help as a private client, we do family law, we do divorces, child visitation, and custody, we write wills, do trust, probate wills when someone has passed. If you know somebody who needs help with social security, disability, we have a good win record on that. I do transgender documents, and we do criminal defense. That's the end of the commercial. You have my permission to post this PowerPoint on the website, and I'm looking forward to y'all getting that flash drive of those 40 years of stuff. I keep saying 40 years. This is still September. It was 41 years ago this month that I came out and went in full time with my wife's blessing and encouragement. So that's where you can find me. That's where I'm going to stop. And I'm going to take questions and answers and tell y'all. Tell me go home.
And everybody, let's please keep it a question, and let's keep it very brief so we can get lots of people to participate. Thank you.
Morning, how are you doing? This is something I've always wondered. Obviously, for the longest time, Houston is not. It's not had a reputation as being as progressive as, say, San Francisco, Philadelphia, Seattle, etc. And there's probably some truth to that. However, Houston has beat San Francisco, Seattle, some of these other supposedly more progressive cities in having the first openly gay mayor, the first transgender judge. And how do you think an urban community in Houston that's a tad bit more conservative than some of these other metropolitan areas actually beat these supposedly more progressive metropolitan areas in having making these milestones?
Well, the way it is that people come out with closet. That's the way it is any place. If people come out with closet, not only as being LGBTIQ, but also as being a straight and supportive ally, people come out with closet. I don't know. I know Denise Parker was very out, and she ran her race, and I've been very out, and she appointed me, and the city of Houston itself, when they vote differently than the Harris County and Trenton counties. It's kind of like Dallas. Dallas, the city itself, votes differently than the surrounding suburbs. So I guess the city of Houston, we had a bigot flight, and they left the city, and now to the outskirts. I have no idea, but I'm out. I will always be out, and I encourage you to be out in your support, not only of LGBTIQ, but against all this racist crap that's going on. Right now, let me just tell you a quick story. When I started practicing law down at the criminal courthouse, back then there was a cafeteria in the basement, which is no longer there because the criminal courthouse has moved. But there was still some segregation, which was not mandatory, but there was still some segregation at the tables. There were mixed race tables. And there were some Hispanic mostly tables, and there were some black mostly tables. I found during the early days of my being out at the courthouse, where people were getting used to me and finding out that I could win at the courthouse, that I always felt more comfortable at the mostly black or mostly brown tables during the first couple of years. And I know that's true, as one of my black attorney friends told me. The reason why you are accepted amongst us is because you aren't judged by where you went to school. You aren't judged by your track record. You aren't judged by your friendly nature. You are judged by your outward appearance, just like we are judged by our outward appearance. So you know what it's like, and we know what it's like that you go through, so you're always welcome here. And since then, I've been very, very welcome and open arms with people of color community. So that's all I can tell you. Where's the mic?
Right here. All those laws and statutes that are restricting and attacked that you showed, pretty frustrating. But if and when a regular administration comes in at the federal level, how quickly can it kind of get back to where it was? How quickly can all that BS be reversed?
I don't know, but that's another almost three and a half years from now, number one. And number two, most of this was executive order or rulemaking by various federal agencies. I'm sure that by then, the military question will have been settled in the courts. The education question will have been settled in the courts. So I think that by the time this school is gone, most of this is going to be settled by the courts. And it's really going to go up to the United States Supreme Court. So how are they going to rule? I have no clue. I know how they ruled in Obergefell, which was the same-sex marriage. And the makeup really hasn't changed. We just traded one bigot for another bigot. But it's going to be, again, this is an outward closet thing, which Supreme Court justices, especially the conservative ones, know transgender people. Now, why do I say that? Because remember the military thing that happened that blew up a couple of months ago? Orrin Hatch, of all people, said, I know transgender people, they're okay, they should be allowed to stay in line. Orrin Hatch. So it's really a matter of coming out of the closet. Again, not only is it LGBT, but if you know somebody that knows a Supreme Court justice and you're straight, tell them to tell them to tell them to tell them, you know, vote right. When the case comes to you, that's what's going to happen. Sorry, I don't have a better answer. Come out. Yeah.
Should we be pushing for legislation mandating unisex restrooms?
No, restroom really is not a big issue because, again, no one goes into a restroom to do anything except go to the restroom, unless they want to cause trouble. And we've got plenty of laws. And you don't even have to live in Texas. You can go to any state. Google any state's criminal statutes. Google Tennessee. Google North Dakota. Google Nevada. Go to their penal code or their criminal code or whatever. Google search for this masturbation, rape, whatever. And it's always there. It's always there. So anybody who goes into a restroom to do that is subject to arrest already. And some law that says you can't go into that bathroom, somebody's going to break a major law. They're not going to fool with it. They're not going to be impeded by a minor law, is all I'm saying. I know a lot of private clubs and bars and restaurants and stuff like this, more and more, are just putting restroom on their door, and then whenever they go through updating their facilities, they are creating single-sex restroom. The Americans with Disabilities Act have offered a lot of help because there's any place that is updated, whether it's a new hospital or a new store or a new whatever, they have restroom facilities, a lot of one-holders is what I call them, where, you know, it just says, it has a men's symbol with a wheelchair, a women's symbol with a wheelchair. You can go to any filling station, convenience store, and they have one-holders. And, you know, any transgender person who doesn't pass very well, they know where the one-holders are, believe me, because they don't want to have any trouble with the law. And I'm sure there's a lot of women who really have to go bad and go to those restrooms, go to those convenience stores, and there's a line of the women's, and there's no line of the men's, and some guy comes walking out the men's, and the woman will follow on in there, because they got to pee. I've done that myself. Fortunately, the men's are usually dirty, but that's why we squat. And you know why. I know this is video, but that's the reality. So I hope that answered your question. Next.
Here, back in the back.
Right here.
Good.
Right here. Yeah.
So first off, I want to say that I really appreciate that you brought up that businesses play a really large role in making sure that that most recent legislation didn't pass, because I remember, you know, with Governor Abbott saying, talking about how pro-business he is. Whenever the business community is saying, we don't want this, that basically gives lie to that kind of thing that you're being consistent. So, and I guess my question is, I feel, I work for Shell Oil, they even sent out, I think recently, in our public emails, they sent out profiling of our transgender employees.
Yeah.
And I feel like we've taken pretty good policies and been pretty progressive with a lot of this stuff, but it seems like a lot of times the left views business as like an enemy many times. My counselor says that, like, that, you know, somehow by being involved in business or corporations, that this is something that we can't work with. And I guess what I'm wondering is, how do you think people that lean towards the left can do a better job at recognizing the allies that they have, such as business, in going and blocking these things people are trying to push and promoting things that they want to push?
Well, you can go to the hrc.org website and click on the things. Button called Workforce, but that might not be it. But you can look pretty quickly and see all the Fortune 500 companies that have the HRC endorsement. And I'm not going to tell you to boycott anything, but you can certainly decide where you're going to spend your dollars. And you can probably go to the Association of Business website because they were very supportive killing the restroom law. And again, see where you spend your money. I know there's several gasoline retailers that I haven't bought their gas for decades now, and I won't tell you who they are on camera. But that's what you do. You tell your friends, you know, I'm buying from such and such, or I'm not buying from such and such because that's how you do it.
Do we have time at all for one more? I know lots of people have questions, but we'll chat with her afterwards.
Thank you, and thanks for your talk. I'm a lawyer. I practiced law in D.C. for 25 years, and I did a lot of work first with the AIDS epidemic and the mayor, and then eventually with the transgender community. But it was complicated because there's three jurisdictions. There's D.C., there's Maryland, and there's Virginia, and every state had different laws about what you needed to do to change your gender identity.
Yeah.
What does Texas require?
Texas requires, and there's a statute for name change, and it's straightforward. But there is no statute as far as gender identity goes. And so that's when you need someone like me who knows what they're doing. Because I take people every single month. I'm taking one next Friday. Actually, I'm taking two next Friday. I've been doing this for decades. And I take people from all over the state in front of judges and get the name changed by statute and get the gender identity mark changed where there is no statute with, here goes Trump again, no surgery at all. So, I'm for high.
Ladies and gentlemen,